as we come before the Lord this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful Sabbath day. We thank you for this opportunity to be together as a family to worship you. And we claim your promise that when two or more are gathered together in your name, that you are here. Please come and fill us with your presence. Open up our hearts and our minds to your truth. And place your love inside of our hearts that we might be an effective witness for you as we leave this place. I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. morning, everyone. As you may have already figured out, today's a special children's worship presentation. Before we get to that, before I invite Debbie and Marina forward, let's read together our Easter-themed purpose of the church. I believe we have that available, right? If not, it's on the front of your bulletin. So I invite you to read with me. Here it is. All right, let's read together. The Father has raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And the Father placed all things under Christ's feet and appointed him to be head over us, the church, which is his body, that we might serve the world as he did. So, again, Debbie has put so much work into this weekend's presentation, and I know just ongoing everything that's happening with children's worship. So, Debbie, I invite you to come forward to share a little presentation with us.
Thank you, Shane. And also, thank you, choir. That was beautiful and inspiring. It's such a blessing to worship with the children in the congregation each Sabbath when we have children's worship away in our individual rooms in these special places that are prepared for, especially for them to worship. And we listen to the stories of God together and we reflect on what God has done and what he is still doing. But we prepare for this through training, either through doorkeeper training that we have here at the church on an afternoon, or through more long, extensive training in the Godly Play and Young Children curriculum. And then we go deeper into learning the stories so that we can tell the essential parts of the story. And we go into the Word ourselves in preparation, and we prepare the environment. And then on the day of, when everything is ready, we pray with our team member, with the storyteller or the doorkeeper. And then frequently we're amazed at what happens, and we know it's not just our work. I want to thank all of our team members, all of the storytellers, doorkeepers, those who help with the materials, and I hope you saw probably their names before church started. But anyway, I want to thank each one who has helped us through this past August. Our year is kind of like the school year, so it's this past August through this coming June. And then also I want to thank the previous children's worship staff who have moved on to other responsibilities, but then they still come back to help us when it's needed, and we really appreciate that. Marina joined us this last summer, and with a rookie, but she's great. And so we want to share with you more about this special program that is quite different from all the other important and wonderful children's programs that we have. And then we also want to give you some glimpses of what happens in a children's worship service and why what we do. So Marina, I was so glad when you told me last year that you would be a doorkeeper. And then we had the little training here at the church with other doorkeepers. And then when you said, oh, I'll be a storyteller, and I mentioned going to Godly Play training, how did you feel about that, and what did you gain from that more extensive training?
Hi, church. As I was saying, yeah, I'm one of the new ones, but I love doing this. When Debbie asked me to help, I'm like, well, yes, you know, I'm involved already. I'm with my kids. I'm already here. I can do this. So I started helping as a doorkeeper. So you're just there kind of assisting. It's a more laid-back job, even though it's very, very important. But then when she asked me, would you be okay storytelling, I'm like, yeah, I can storytell. You know, I'm a mom. I storytell all the time. So, but she said, oh, but you have to go through a three-day training. And yes, I'm like, wow, that sounds like kind of like a legal seminar. No, please. But it just sounded so serious. And I was like, wow, she must be a real perfectionist, because I kind of figure any mom can tell a story. So, but I went to the training, and it literally opened my mind into a complete different way of approaching Bible teaching to our kids. It has changed the way I teach my own kids at home, and it has completely changed the way that I tell the stories to them during children's worship. The training is very, very specific. There's a reason why everything is done a certain way. Everything in the classroom is set at their eye level, which might sound like something trivial, but if you think about the fact that children are here or here, or I'm not very tall, but I'm still taller than them. And if everything around you is all the way up there, it doesn't feel like it's intended for you. So even that simple thing of having things at their level, the way we speak to them, the way we make them get ready, I feel like the whole program is set for them, is basically setting them up for success, not for failure. So the training, I absolutely loved it. I drove Debbie crazy when I came back. I had like sent her an email, 10 pages with all new ideas. And she's like, okay, let's do one thing at a time. So yes, the training is important. What we're doing with your kids, we do it because we love doing it. But the church is putting time and resources into acknowledging how important this is, and for you to know that also this training has been prepared by doctors, pastors, and educators after 20, 30 years of research with kids. So this is not something that we're kind of like just okay improvising. It's well thought, and it works.
Thank you, Maria. Yeah. That was great. So when we talk about part of the worship service being contemplative or reflective, a lot of people think, I don't think my child would sit quietly through a service like that and listen to a story told simply. And so how would you respond to that kind of question?
Yeah, well, believe it or not, they sit still the whole story. And some parents are lucky and their kid is a little angel and they bring them to the sanctuary and he just sits there or she just sits there. My kids are angels, but not that kind of angel. I would come with bags of stuff for them to do. I have my quiet book and the other quiet book and the crayons and the snacks. And I was stressing out because they were still talking. But for some reason, that, as I said, is not random. It has been thought, when we prepare them for our story, the way that we prepare, the way that we sit down, we're all looking at each other, we sit in a circle, we sit at their level, we're on the floor, we take our shoes off, we're comfortable. And kids listen the whole story. And you would be amazed, even the most fidgety kids, the one that have the wiggles at home all the time, they don't do it there. Yeah.
It really is amazing. And then at the end of the story, because we have all these different times that we have to do things, but at the end of the story, we always ask what we call wondering questions. And they sound actually like statements because we started off with, I wonder what, you know, but it's actually a question. We're inviting the kids to respond back. And actually, just a little before you get back to Marina telling us about what happens, later today, when you see children's worship in the bulletin, we invite you to look at part of children's worship service here in the sanctuary, and Annette will present the story, and then she will mention these I wonder questions. And we have several kids who have looked at the answers, not the answers, we haven't given them answers because it's what however you want to respond, but they've looked at the questions ahead of time and thought about what they might want to answer. But we also invite each and every one of you to think about how you would respond. And if you would like to share that with the congregation, we would really appreciate it. Just raise your hand and someone will bring you the handheld mic so that you can share your thought too. And I want you to know that in the worship centers, we affirm many different responses to a same question. And so likewise here, if you hear, you know, you hear a response, but feel free to give your own response. The kids aren't performing today. It's really worship time for us all. So thinking about wondering questions, that's another thing that sometimes we think, okay, how much would little kids to preteens that may not want to talk so much to each other, would they really reflect together? And how would you respond to that, Marina, about wondering time?
Well, the wondering time is my favorite time of children's worship because kids are so fresh, so honest, and the way the questions are set up makes them understand that there's no right or wrong answer. This is a time where I want to know how the story made you feel, or how you find yourself in the story, or maybe you don't, or how you liked or disliked something. But sometimes hearing the older kids talk, it's amazing. You're reminded of how, you know, these are little projects of adults that we're about to put out into the world. And I'm happy to say that our projects of adults here at Vallejo are amazing. You guys have great kids. And sometimes I'm even blown away with the little ones. I was a couple of weeks ago, I think it was like my first or second story, and I was with the youngest kids, and we were telling the story of Zacchaeus. And one of the questions was, if Zacchaeus was lost. And I had a four-year-old respond, well, he wasn't lost like I got lost in the supermarket with my mom, but he was lost in his head. He knew what was right, and he knew what was wrong, but he still couldn't do the right thing. And this is a four-year-old, you know? And I love that. And I think that's the best part of what we're doing. We're making our kids read these stories that we have heard a million times and really, really go deep into them and find a way to apply them to their life. So, yeah.
Wonderful, wonderful. And it is truly amazing to hear what they say. After the wondering time, then the kids are dismissed for their individual work time. And they can choose to work with the story materials of the day, or they can work with art materials to respond how they feel about the story or whatever. So one of the anecdotes that I just want to share real quick before we finish is that one of the storytellers was telling the story of Jesus' last Passover, and a little girl chose to work with those materials. And the storyteller noticed that she was telling the whole story to herself and was even moving the items of the story materials herself just the way she had seen, even to the part of breaking the bread. And then another time, I was in the room with the older kids, and at work time, a boy had chosen to work with a desert box. It could be called a sand box because it really is a box with sand in it. But we call it a desert box because we say there's so many important things that happen in the desert that we need part of it here to help us tell the stories. So this boy was working with the desert box, and he had chosen the story of the 10 best ways. And I glanced over, and he had buried the red box in the sand. I was puzzled by that, and so I asked him about it. And he opened the top of the red box and said, "It's like buried treasure with the Ten Commandments inside." Once again, we were just so touched by what he said, what the children say, by the work of the Holy Spirit. And we just invite you, we want you to know more about what's happening so you can continue to pray for us, and we encourage your kids to come, your own kids or grandkids or nieces or nephews or neighbors. And then also, if you would like to become involved with this ministry, please talk to one of us about it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Kids, it's time for children's story.
I want you to sit up here so that you can see our story, our presentation this morning. So sit where you can see. If you sit too far back, you won't be able to see. Children's Worship Center has grown this morning, and we have some children that are a little older than you are, but we are so happy that they're here with us today. Since we've already come in, we've told each other that we are ready to enter the Worship Center. Let's sing our song to just get us really ready to listen to what we're going to learn from the Word of God. Okay. Those of you that know our song, sing it nice and loud so that some of the other children will be able to follow along. Okay? Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. Be celebrating the mystery of Easter. And we use a white cloth to remind us that Jesus died, but he didn't stay there. He rose again. And that is such a wonderful mystery. This is the color red. I love the color red. I wonder why we are going to use the color red today. The white reminds us that Jesus rose again. Let's find out what the red is going to remind us of. The day that Jesus rose again from the dead, he appeared to the 11 disciples and all the followers of Jesus that were with them. He told them, "Don't be scared, peace." He told them, "My peace I bring you. Just as the Father has given me peace, I bring it to you." And he did something very, very special. He actually breathed on them. He breathed on them. And he told them that he was going to give them the gifts of the Holy Spirit in order to prepare them for the work that they had to do. Now, when Jesus gave the disciples these gifts, they could do and say things that they had not ever been able to do before. He gave them these gifts so that they could tell others about the kingdom of God. These weren't just gifts for them to have. They had a special purpose. He gave them the gift of wisdom. This gift is seeing God and how he works through his love in the world. He gave them the gift of understanding. The gift of understanding is knowing what God is saying. He gave them the gift of counsel. Helping someone make the right choice. Not bossing them around, but helping them make the right choice. He gave them the gift of power. Not power of us to have power ourselves, but this is the power of God's strength that helps us do what is right. He gave them the gift of knowledge. The gift of knowledge to know God more deeply. He gave them the gift of fear of the Lord. This is not for us to be afraid. The gift is the great respect that we have because God is so, so great. He also gave them the gift of delight. Delight. This is the joy in the presence of the Lord. This is the gift that we are all experiencing right now, being in God's presence. When the disciples received these gifts, they were so happy, they were filled with love. They ran out and told everybody they could find about the love of Jesus. They started telling people about the way of the kingdom of God. They didn't keep it to themselves. They told people in Jerusalem, they told people in Judea, they told people in Samaria, and soon this wonderful word about the kingdom of God spread all over the world. That was the purpose of the gifts. It was to help them prepare for the work that they needed to do. These gifts are not only for the disciples. These gifts are for each and every one of us. These gifts are our gifts to receive. They are our gifts to discover. And when we become followers of Jesus, when we say, I believe, I want to be with Jesus, every single one of these gifts becomes our gift as well. Sometimes we have to figure out what the gift really means and what we are supposed to do with it. So at this point, I'm going to ask some of the children to come up and receive a gift. Aaron, do you want to come up and receive your gift of wisdom? And we use the Christ candle because this is where we get all our power. It is from God, from Christ, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit then gives us the gift. Victoria, you want to come up and receive the gift of knowing? Receive the gift of knowing. Come around and put in front of your candle. Claire, do you want to come up and receive the gift of counsel? Helping someone make the right decision here. I'm going to light it for you, okay? Where's Jericho? Jericho, do you want to come receive the gift of strength and power? Wonderful. Thank you, Jericho. Aaron, please come and receive your gift of knowledge, knowing God more deeply. And come and receive your gift of the fear of the Lord. Alenia, do you want to come up and receive your gift of delight, joy in the presence of the Lord? Told his disciples that his gifts were not going to go away when they left that room. These gifts were going to be with them wherever they went, in every way and every day. Let's enjoy the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Wisdom, knowledge, counsel, strength, fear of the Lord, delight. These gifts are yours, and when we leave this room, they will be with you. They will not leave you. And those of you that came up and accepted these gifts are yours. They are yours forever. I wonder how you are going to feel if you receive the gift of wisdom. Grown-ups can also speak. Yes.
I would use that wisdom that how God used it for people, how he gave strength and showed the world who he is and loved.
I wonder what you would do after accepting the gift of understanding.
I'll share the word and have other people understand what the Lord did.
Thank you. I wonder what you would do after accepting the gift of counsel. How can someone else make the right choice?
Help other people understand God and make good choices.
Amen. what happens every week in there. Just see how the spirit works on these children. This is one of the children from our youngest class. It's just amazing. It's just amazing. I wonder what you would do after accepting the gift of power.
The gift of power is you have the strength to do the right thing.
Amen. That's right. Thank you. I wonder what you would do after accepting the gift of knowledge.
Because I want to be like him.
I wonder what you would do after accepting the gift of the fear of God. Yes, Caleb.
I would respect God and listen to him.
Thank you, Caleb. Thank you so much. I wonder what you would do after accepting the gift of delight.
I would share it with the world and those who don't have it.
Thank you. I want any of the grown-ups who have a response to a wondering question to please, you can also respond at this time if anybody wants to. I want all of you to remember, we've enjoyed the beautiful gifts of the Holy Spirit here this morning. And I want you to remember that they are not only going to stay in this place, that they are going to go with you in everywhere you go and in every way that you go. We leave our Christ candle lit at the end of our presentations. We gather in a circle, and that's the time that we open the scriptures. We read something from the Old Testament and the New Testament that is the basis for the story for the presentation that we have done. And I'm going to be reading from Isaiah 11:2. A shoot will come up from here. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots, a branch will bear fruit. The spirit of the Lord will rest on him. The spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the spirit of counsel and of power, the spirit of knowledge and all of the fear of the Lord. And he will delight in the fear of the Lord. At the end, we turn off our Christ candle and we remind ourselves that what we have learned in our place goes with us wherever we go. And then we sing our song. Go, go in peace, go in peace. May the love of God around you everywhere, everywhere you may go. Watch where I put the materials away, and during your work time, when we are back there, then you can also work with these materials.
forward to do the scripture reading, and the rest of the children, you can return to your seats now.
This scripture for today is from the book of John, chapter 20, verses 19 through 23. We are doing the scripture as a responsive reading. Please read along with the scripture printed in black.
On the first evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for the fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said,
"Peace be with you."
After this, he said this. He showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said,
"Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you."
And with that, he breathed on them and
"Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven."
Please kneel if you're able. Dear Lord, thank you for our children. Thank you for allowing us the opportunity to work with them, to guide them, and to be a part of their lives. Thank you for our church family. We ask you to please pour the gifts of the Holy Spirit over our church family, and that we may leave today with our spirits filled. Thank you, Jesus. In your name, amen.
Simple and to the point that it's far more effective than what we do up here, but especially true today. That was a wonderful presentation. Thank you again to all the children's ministry leaders and for the wonderful work that they do. Thank you guys for all of your participation. I will just share, if you expect it or not, one more brief thought on this morning's gospel reading, this story of Jesus on that evening of the day of the resurrection, who shares the Holy Spirit with the disciples. So, the Bible says, we just read it, that the disciples are locked in a room, right? They've hidden themselves away and locked the door. And why did they lock the door? You read it. We all read it together. Why is the door locked? For fear. Right? And why would they be afraid? Well, because their master was just put to death, right? They don't know what's going to happen to them next, especially since at this point in the story, they've gone to the tomb and seen that it was empty. But they've yet to see Jesus, so they don't know what's going to happen. Maybe they'll be blamed for stealing Jesus' body. You see, the women had reported to them, the women have seen Jesus, and they told the male disciples, but they didn't believe. And so here they are, locked away for fear. And to me, this strikes me as a very appropriate image for the church, the disciples huddled together in fear. Because how often do you think in this space we are gathered together, in a sense, with the doors locked? We gather together here because we feel safe, we feel comfortable here, but we're afraid to go out, right? But just as with anything, and I think of so many sort of natural images come to mind, but like a body of water, right, that doesn't have an outlet, what happens to it? Without running water, without it moving, it becomes stagnant and moldy and dead, right? And that's exactly what happens to the church. A church closed in on itself becomes full of infighting because we're more concerned with the politics in here than the mission out there, right? This is what we see with these disciples closed in on themselves, afraid to go out. So if we are like these disciples, it's possible that we gather together every week and we have each other, but like these disciples, they have each other, but they don't have Jesus. So what happens in this situation, locked away in fear, when Christ appears to them? He has a very simple message, and that's what I want to spend just a minute discussing with you. The first thing he says is, "Peace be with you." And he showed them his hands and his side, and he says again, "Peace be with you." Why peace? But because they're afraid. And this is the promise of Scripture. The Apostle Paul says in Philippians 3, "The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God." And what? "And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." This is the promise of prayer. You see, this is the peace that God gives you. The promise of peace is not a promise that we will be spared suffering or pain or loss or death. We will experience those things, but the promise is that through it all, God will give us his peace. One of the choir pieces this morning was this passage from John chapter 14, where Jesus says, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives, so do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." So we may like to end the message here with the message of peace, but you see there's a kind of inversion that happens because Jesus says, "Peace be with you," as he shows the disciples the wounds in his hand and in his side. And as he shows them these wounds, he says, "As the Father has sent me, I send you." What do you suppose is going on there? Jesus is showing them, this is what happened to me on my mission. And just as the Father sent me, now I'm sending you. It's an indication to the disciples that they too must go out. And when they go out, they will suffer. They will suffer for the gospel because the good news, as we've said, is not a message of comfort and wealth. It is a message of poverty and suffering. But there is a promise of peace through it all. And then it says he breathed on them, saying, "Receive the Holy Spirit." And it's crucial that we see the relationship between receiving the Holy Spirit and being sent out. He says, "As the Father sent me, I send you." And he breathed on them, saying, "Receive the Holy Spirit." We have to see this connection. Receiving the Holy Spirit and being sent out are two sides of the same coin. We are sent out, just as the Father sent Christ, because, and only because, Christ has given us his Spirit. That's why he breathes on them. This may be a kind of a strange image for us, Jesus breathing on the disciples, but in both Greek and Hebrew, the word for spirit is the same as the word for breath. So when he breathes on them, what is he doing but giving them his own spirit? Giving them the Holy Spirit. You see, going all the way back to the beginning, when Jesus is conceived, Scripture tells us that Jesus was conceived or born by the Holy Spirit. What exactly does that mean? Let's think about that for just a moment. Jesus was conceived even by the Holy Spirit. What is the Holy Spirit? What are we talking about when we say the Holy Spirit? For all eternity, God has existed as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Father and the Son exist in this state of ceaseless and perfect love for each other. The Father and Son exist in perpetual love for each other, and the Holy Spirit is their very shared breath. The Holy Spirit is the love shared between the Father and the Son. So when the Bible says, for instance, in 1 John 4:8, the great interpreters of Scripture through the ages have always identified this as the Holy Spirit. When we say that God is love itself, we're talking about the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the love of God personified. So imagine the Father and the Son existing in all eternity with this wind, this breath of the Holy Spirit being constantly given and exchanged. That word Spirit invites us to see this as a kind of inhaling and exhaling. The Father and Son caught in this eternal exchange of love, giving and receiving this gift of the Holy Spirit between each other. So then when this gift of God, this love of God, this Spirit of God is poured out on the Virgin Mary, it conceives in her the very person of the Son of God and gives humanity to Jesus Christ. So you see then, when you have that imagery of what the Holy Spirit is, the Holy Spirit is the bond of love between the Father and the Son. If you understand that, then you understand why it's the greatest of all miracles that we would receive the Holy Spirit. It's unimaginable. And it's because when we receive the Holy Spirit, we are being invited in to that most intimate of all relationships between the Father and the Son. And that's why the Bible says that the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of our adoption. The Spirit of our adoption. Think about that. Because if the Holy Spirit is this gift between the Father and the Son, then if we receive the Holy Spirit, what does that make us but children of God? Members of that bond of love. Paul says in Romans 8:14, "For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, 'Abba, Father,' it is the very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God." You see, when we call God Father, that's only because we have received the Spirit of God. And we've been caught into that relationship. And so again, John writes, and this is a passage that all of you know, but I hope maybe now you'll see it in a new light. 1 John 4:1, he writes, "Behold what manner of love the Father has given to us that we should be called," what? "Children of God." Do you see the Trinitarian structure of that? Behold what manner of love, the Spirit, the Father has given to us that we should be called children of God. You can see now why Jesus says, "As the Father sent me, I send you." He gives them the gift of the Holy Spirit because it is by receiving the Holy Spirit that we ourselves become children of God. Therefore, the mission of Jesus becomes our mission. And this is the last thing I want to say, is that the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of our adoption, but the Holy Spirit is also the Spirit of our mission. You see, Christ, the word Christ, or Messiah in Hebrew, means what? Most of you know this, right? What does Messiah mean? Anybody? The anointed one, right? The one who's anointed. So even when it's translated into Greek, so Messiah means the anointed one. The Greeks didn't have that same custom of anointing. So the word Christ literally means like sort of the oiled one, or even the greasy one, the way they would, athletes would put oil on themselves in a wrestling match. So the word Christ, it took a little while for people to figure out what they meant by that exactly, because it's a cultural thing. So the word Christ or Messiah means anointed one, right? Because in the Old Testament, in the Hebrew culture, a prophet, a priest, a king would be anointed with oil as a sign of their mission and their calling. But all of this was foreshadowing the Messiah, the anointed one, who would be anointed not with oil, but with the Holy Spirit, to be a prophet, a priest, and a king. So Jesus is anointed with the Holy Spirit, and so as he says in his first sermon, he says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to do what? To bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And this is what is now happening with the apostles. The word apostle means the one who is sent. They are sent out into the world, not just as mere representatives, but as themselves now children of God. Themselves now anointed ones, in a sense, because Christ gives them his own spirit. And that's why we can come to that surprising claim in verse 23 where Jesus says, "If you forgive the sins of any, they're forgiven. If you do not forgive the sins of any, they are not forgiven." What do we make of this, other than that Christ has given to the church his own mission of reconciling the world to himself? Paul says the same thing in 2 Corinthians 5. He says, God reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. So we are ambassadors for Christ. Since God is making his appeal through us, we entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. You see that we are sent out on the mission of Jesus. We are sent out as Christ into the world. Because we have received the Holy Spirit, Christ's mission is our mission. We have to stop being disciples, hiding behind locked doors, and become apostles sent out into the world delivering the good news of God's love and forgiveness. Christ's mission is our mission. Christ's work is our work. We call his Father our Father because he has made his Spirit to be our Spirit. Amen? I invite the deacons to come forward to collect the offering. Thank you. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your gift, the gift of your love poured out into our hearts. So now we offer ourselves back to you. We return to you our lives, ourselves, our love. We pray that this would be an acceptable offering to you. We pray through Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you to stand with me as we sing our closing hymn, Christ for the World. This is our mission song, so I hope that this will inspire you to go out and serve the world as Christ to your neighbor. Send us your Holy Spirit to conform us to the image of your Son. In all things we pray through his name. Amen.